Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Heritage Foundation. We'd appreciate everyone please taking their seats so we can begin our program promptly. Again, thank you for joining us at the Heritage Foundation in our Douglas and Sarah Allison Auditorium. I'm John Hilbolt, Director of Lectures and Seminars, and it's my privilege to welcome you, those joining us on the heritage.org website, and those joining us on C-SPAN TV. We would ask everyone in-house to make sure that your cell phones have been turned off, especially when weather bulletins come. It's amazing what happens in a room. And, of course, we encourage you to watch our program again online following. It will be posted for everyone's future reference as well. Hosting our guest today and welcoming her to Heritage and introducing our special program, pending his BlackBerry, is the Honorable Edwin Meese. Mr. Meese, of course, served as the 75th Attorney General of the United States and serves Heritage as the Ronald Reagan Distinguished Fellow Emeritus in our Center for Legal and Judicial Studies. Mr. Meese.
Thank you, John. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure for me to join John in welcoming you to the Heritage Foundation and particularly to the annual Joseph Story Distinguished Lecture. This is our most prestigious legal event of our Legal Center's Preserve the Constitution series. And it's also part of our Legal Strategy Forum, which is taking place today and tomorrow, where the CEOs and primary legal officers of the freedom-based public interest law organizations throughout the country, some 40 of them, get together to plan their efforts to defend the Constitution and to bring justice to the people of the United States. So we're glad to have them with us in the audience this evening. The lecture, of course, is named after the Supreme Court Justice Joseph Story for two reasons. First, because of his dedication to the Constitution, and secondly, because of his influence on the law. He had at one of the most outstanding impacts on the development of our system of justice and particularly the development of the law itself in the United States during his time on the court. As a matter of fact, Oliver Wendell Holmes particularly said that Story had, who did not always agree with Justice Story, said that he had done more than any other English-speaking man in this century, to make the law luminous and easy to understand. He also served as a professor of law at Harvard University. And he was almost single-handedly brought that university's law school into being since the year before he arrived, they had only one student. He expanded the student body as a part of his contribution to the law there. It's also interesting to note that while on the Supreme Court, he continued pattern that the early justices always followed to ride circuit and for the appellate courts and occasionally trial courts in the northeastern part of the United States, while at the same time continuing to teach at Harvard and also to do his duties on the Supreme Court of the United States. So he really had a very busy schedule that he followed and carried out in a very distinguished and dedicated manner. Well, noting Justice Story's experience and his broad reach of his activities relating to the justice system, we have tonight a distinguished guest who has an even broader experience in the law. She has literally had experience in virtually every aspect of our justice system. She is married to Dewey Parker, who is with us here this evening. She graduated from the UCLA Law School and received her LLM degree from the University of Virginia in their graduate program for judges. Between, to show the variety of her experience, between graduation from law school and her appointment to the federal bench, she served, first of all, in every branch of California government. She drafted bills initially in her first experience in the Legislative Council's office, dealing there with the state legislature. She served in the Attorney General's office, which is almost a separate branch in California. She was Deputy Secretary and General Counsel of the state's Business, Transportation, and Housing organization there, and then ultimately was Legal Affairs Secretary to Governor Pete Wilson. She then had experience in private practice in one of the state's distinguished law firms there, and then went on to her experience in the judiciary, first as an associate justice of the Third District Court of Appeal in Sacramento, and then on the California Supreme Court. Because of this vast experience and her distinguished service, in 2005, President George W. Bush appointed her as the judge of the Court of Appeals for the District of Columbia Circuit, where she continues her distinguished service to our nation. So, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in recognizing the Joseph Story Distinguished Lecturer for the year 2014, the Honorable Janice Rogers Brown.
Well, thank you. You are a lovely audience. I probably should sit down now. But I want to thank the Heritage Foundation for asking me to deliver this year's Joseph Story Lecture. I am honored and frankly a bit intimidated to be in such company. I have attended many of the other lectures. I especially want to express my gratitude to Ed Meese for his friendship, for his many kindnesses, and for being such a mensch. For those of you who do not speak Yiddish, it means a man of integrity and honor. But for General Meese's courage and integrity, conversations like this probably would not be taking place. We are all indebted beyond anything we can repay because he took seriously his oath to support and defend the Constitution. This is where I, thank you. This is where I usually offer my caveats and tell people I'm not a scholar or a philosopher and certainly not a theologian. But today I'm gonna do something a little different, and I'm gonna speak as a conservative and as a conservative judge. One who has the good fortune to be particularly ill-educated. Having escaped an Ivy League education, I now find myself free to think however I like. I suppose if I had been around when Judge Story was teaching at Harvard, I might have rethought that. But as a conservative, I spend most of my time thinking about the present evils of this world, unlike my liberal counterparts who spend their time thinking up new ones. And these days, frankly, I find myself a little bit like Gladys Knight, thinking I've really got to use my imagination to think of good reasons to keep on keeping on. And for those of you too young to know Gladys, YouTube. As I grow older, I have developed a new appreciation for Justice Asbury's plaintiff query, reform, reform, aren't things bad enough already? Perhaps that is why, of late, conservative discussions about the Constitution and about American constitutionalism generally have had a distinctly remedial, if not downright elegiac, tone. We speak of restoring, reviving, rehabilitating, repairing, and defending the Constitution. I do not think our sense of urgency is overblown. Our panic is justified. The title of this speech adds my incremental bit to the theme of preserving the fortress of our liberties. My analogy is drawn from the stonemason. I suggest we might also consider repointing the Constitution. Some of you, those who do not live in old brick buildings, may be unfamiliar with that term. When we first moved to Washington, D.C., we purchased a row house in the district. And being from the Valley, California, a part that has little experience of row houses or old houses of any kind, we were completely unprepared to deal with the maintenance required for structures that had been withstanding the elements for more than a century. But even as we were stacking moving boxes, our next-door neighbors dropped by to warn us to expect strong smells, noise, and dust because they were having their house repointed. Our response was, "What?" They explained that the failure of brick and mortar structures was more likely to result from the degradation of the mortar between the bricks than any other cause. Periodically, the old cement must be cleaned out and replaced. It is a painstaking and labor-intensive process, and as I learned more about it, I became aware of the critical importance of the replacement cement having properties similar to the original mortar. Newer and stronger cements might actually be too good. According to Ian Cram, author of The Art of the Stonemason, modern materials can hasten the deterioration of the stone by being so unyielding that, over the seasons of change, they actually crack the bricks, a calamity nothing can repair. The result is a pile of rubble. Thus, repointing seemed the perfect analogy to our task in supporting and defending the Constitution. Is it not the new ingredient, progressivism, the love child of the modern Enlightenment and its chief handmaiden, postmodernism, that has ruined the constitutional edifice and impoverished our original understandings? So we must ask ourselves, what were the ingredients of that mortar, that binding spell, that gave us statesmen like Adams and Madison, judges like Marshall and Story, and presidents like Washington and Lincoln? What made America possible, limited government conceivable? And can we, a polity so greatly changed, recapture the optimism and certitude of the founders in a world of big government and judge-made rights none of them could have imagined? Or was a republic peopled by free men a naive and childish dream to which we wiser, more sophisticated grown-ups should bid good riddance? Though America seemed a miracle, was it only a product of its time, destined to fail as the sensibilities that produced it faded from the national conscience? Is there anything to be learned about constitutional repointing from a judge like Joseph Story? Perhaps. A couple of examples of constitutional interpretation based on two very different species of normative reasoning may bring the issues into clearer focus. At one time, the judge's role in interpreting constitutional texts was based on the anchor of a fixed constitution. Joseph Story was part of that tradition. He was born 3 years after the colonies declared their independence and a year before John Adams helped draft Massachusetts' constitution in 1780, which in language strongly reminiscent of the Declaration confirmed that all men are born free and equal. While Story was still a toddler, the High Court of Massachusetts held those words were incompatible with slavery. Chief Justice Cushing admitted slavery had been an accepted usage in the colony, but he concluded whatever formerly prevailed, a different idea had taken place with the people of America, more favorable to the natural rights of mankind and to that natural innate desire of liberty with which heaven, and I had to quote this part because I loved it so much, without regard to color, complexion, or shape of noses, features, has inspired all the human race. As a man, Story consistently condemned slavery under any shape as utterly repugnant to the natural rights of man. Yet this Jeffersonian Republican who professed he was and always had been a lover, a devoted lover of the Constitution of the United States and a friend of the Union, wrote an opinion in Prigg v. Pennsylvania, declaring a Pennsylvania statute making it substantially more difficult for slave catchers to recover fugitives unconstitutional. Prigg placed the Supreme Court in the midst of an intense national, moral, and political conflict, and the court heard arguments reviling the Constitution, as a damnable pro-slavery compact. But while Story recognized that the Constitution was built on a compromise that did not forbid slavery, he saw the Constitution itself and the Union it sought to perfect as the means by which the wrong would be ameliorated and ultimately eradicated. When Story says Prigg is a triumph of freedom, he foreshadows Lincoln, who would cajole the Civil War Congress, saying they might nobly save or meanly lose the last best hope of earth. Lincoln meant to preserve the Union, which the Constitution had brought into being. Story was prepared to exhibit whatever patience was required to support and defend that Constitution. It might be said of him, as he said of Justice Marshall, that when others despaired of the Republic and would have allowed it to succumb to a stern necessity, he resisted the impulse and clung to the Union and nailed its colors to the mast of the Constitution. Thus, although the natural law jurists of the early period distinguished between the frame of government and personal, as we would say, natural and inalienable rights, which are emphatically not the same as the abstract rights of man, they recognized the natural law as a ground of moral reasoning, but reasoned that exceeding their authority under the positive law would violate the very natural law in whose name they purported to act. Such reasoning included concern about the preservation of the kind of governmental structure which made liberty possible. Unless the framework of limited government, the Constitution of liberty, was preserved, the project would fail. Modern commentators take strong issue with Story's assessment and are sharply critical of Prigg. Professor Ronald Dworkin assumes inaccurately that Story rejected ideas of natural law entirely. Otherwise, says Dworkin, he would have recognized that American constitutionalism presupposed a conception of individual freedom antagonistic to slavery, a conception that should have informed Story's interpretation of the positive law. Similarly, Professor Kent Neumeyer said Story misunderstood the way in which moral choices and political interests necessarily inform legal doctrine. But what Dworkin and Neumeyer identify as moral reasoning has quite a different root than the natural law enterprise. For Dworkin, judicial reasoning in hard cases requires judges to identify abstract principles of justice. For Neumeyer, the problem is Story's certitude. He said had Story not accepted certain intellectual and historical premises, he would not have settled for the easy answer. But both would probably deny that there is any source of normative authority independent of man. In contrast to Story's close attention to the extant Constitution, many modern judges see themselves as translators of the lofty generalities of the evolving Constitution. Consider Justice Brennan's position on the death penalty. In a 1986 speech, he described the Constitution as a public text and a sublime oration on the dignity of man, whose inherent ambiguities judges must resolve. Thus, in the process of translating the majestic generalities of the constitutional text, Justice Brennan concluded, capital punishment is under all circumstances cruel and unusual punishment prohibited by the 8th and 14th Amendments. He acknowledged that his interpretation is one to which neither the majority of his fellow justices nor his fellow countrymen subscribe. He ignores the fact that the text of the Constitution does not forbid capital punishment. Instead, Brennan articulates what he sees as a larger constitutional duty. On this issue, the death penalty, I hope to embody a community, although perhaps not yet arrived, striving for human dignity for all. In short, he would impose his biases to force a community into being, even though the beliefs he seeks to foster contradict the text of the Constitution. In Brennan's view, the judicial task is not the patient, painstaking work of repointing. It is wholesale renovation, much in the spirit of Dworkin's insistence that the broad normative aspirations of the Constitution license judges to identify and impose their own moral principles. Perhaps Justice Story's activity cannot be described as repointing. The Constitution was still too new. But we can see ingredients on which he relied: respect for the positive law, prudence, patient and precise explication, unshakable faith in the natural law's universal objective moral truths. If we are to repoint our Constitution today, these understandings seem to be essential ingredients. Justice Brennan used a different framework. He intuits from the normative ethos of the Constitution a concern about human dignity, a phrase whose meaning in particular circumstances is highly undefined. He then purports to give meaning to those abstract values. Surprisingly, both Justice Story and Justice Brennan are identified as natural law jurists, but it makes little sense to put judges like Story and Marshall in the same camp with judges like Brennan, for the latter would dismiss the principles to which those early judges were devoted as quaint relics of a bygone age. It is easy to trace the trajectory that has landed modern jurisprudence in this predicament, but difficult to fathom why we act as if the transformation was seamless. In 1977, Yale's author Leff reviewed Roberto Unger's book, Knowledge and Politics. Leff's essay, in the form of a memorandum from the devil, identified the problem at the heart of any book on human action. He asks, how does one tell and tell about the difference between right and wrong? Why are one, a person or a society, do any particular thing rather than any other? How can one ground any statement in the form, it is right to do X, in anything firmer than the quicksand of bare reiterated assertion? Leff is admirably candid, not only about the near-term implications of his conclusion, but about the reason for rejecting the obvious solution. If there is no external source on which to ground normative assumptions, the answer to why X will have to be because P believes so, where P is some person or group of persons. I call this the zip code theory of jurisprudence. The enlightened opinion of those people who went to a school in the same zip code that you did. Or because P equals everyone, where P represents the general will. Here, finally, Leff explains the real stakes. If, he tells Unger, human nature is defined as the good, there can be no argument for change. And in that case, an intellectual like Unger, rightly appalled at the world, would have no role at all. To escape that dreadful possibility, the good has to be not what people were now, but what they are becoming or could become ever more perfectly, ever more fully. It is impossible to see this comment without hearing the echo of Lincoln's warning that men of ambition, members of the family of the lion or the tribe of the eagle, who thirst and burn for distinction, will have it, whether at the expense of emancipating slaves or enslaving free men. Unger's book contains this passage. He says, moral discourse always presupposes the acceptance of humanity and the authority of the striving to be and to become ever more human. He goes on, the first assumption is that there is a unitary human nature, though one that changes and develops in history. The second premise is that this human nature constitutes the final basis of moral judgment in the absence of objective values and in the silence of revelation. In 1979, Professor Leff gave us the short and sprightly academic tour de force on the absence of objective values. He said, if we cannot believe in a complete, transcendent, and immanent set of propositions about right and wrong, findable rules that are authoritatively and unambiguously direct us to live righteously, then all premises for any system of ethical rules flounder on the problem of the grand says who. Right? In other words, in order for any normative evaluation to be binding and unquestionable, the evaluator must be beyond question. The evaluator must be the unjudged judge, the unruled legislator, the premise maker who rests on no premise, the uncreated creator of values. In short, the great I am, God. And Leff candidly admits that if God is rejected, the result is the total elimination of any coherent or even more than momentarily convincing ethical or legal system dependent upon finally authoritative extra-systemic premises. This is an academically opaque way of saying, forget about constitutionalism or even a rule of law that is more than skin deep. When man replaces God, the focus is not on God's goodness, but his power. And here it may be useful to contemplate C.S. Lewis's succinct rejoinder to an earlier educational effort. Quote, a dogmatic belief in objective value is necessary to the very idea of a rule that is not tyranny or an obedience which is not slavery. It is on this idea of objective value, the belief that certain attitudes are really true and others really false, that America was established. The founders presumably believed the statement adapted by Thomas Jefferson from the Virginia Declaration of Rights, edited and endorsed by those who founded this republic, quote, We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Lazic Kolakowski proclaims Jefferson's statement the most famous single sentence ever written in the Western Hemisphere. Or he says, perhaps the second most famous, right after Coke is it. For those of you under 30, a more recognizable choice might be just do it. Or for the 40-somethings, may the force be with you. You get the idea. And yet, as Kolakowski acknowledges, what seemed self-evident to Mr. Jefferson would appear either patently false or meaningless and superstitious to the great men who shape our political imagination, men like Aristotle, Machiavelli, Hobbes, Marx, or Nietzsche. Of course, we need not go so far back to find disparagement. We could add the names of American presidents like Wilson and Roosevelt to the list of those who argued for liberation from constitutional piety in favor of a reevaluation of the Constitution. Natural rights and its evil twin, the rights of man, seem to move in an eerie antiphony. Thus, the modern idea of negative rights and economic freedom grew up side by side with the rationalist refusal to accept any dogmatic belief in objective value. This is a big problem for modernity, for limited government, and for liberty. These self-evident truths represent the theoretical proposition on which this nation was founded. And though these principles must be continually reinterpreted to apply to changing circumstances, what future exists for a regime founded on the lex aeterna if no one quite believes in it anymore? This is where the life of a conservative judge who favors limited government becomes difficult. A legal philosophy that does not recognize absolute moral norms cannot limit the state's power. Indeed, it is not clear that a legal philosophy that does recognize absolute moral norms can limit it. But the law is rooted in a series of objective value judgments about morality or justice, or it is about nothing. To divorce the government's monopoly of force from conceptions of what is right and wrong is ultimately to justify tyranny in its most naked form. With pure hearts and good intentions, conservative judges, the judges most convicted of the accuracy of the founders' intuitions, and most anxious to preserve a robust constitutionalism that can effectively limit government, have, instead of defending the Constitution, unilaterally disarmed. With high hopes and grand theories, the proponents of the living Constitution have rewritten the Charter. But the result is inevitably incoherent or illiberal or both. Left's candor is useful in understanding this seemingly perverse result. The consequence of everyone going into business for themselves is not just the eclipse of natural law. It is the privileging of unnatural law. Once nihilist skepticism, more accurately moral nihilism, becomes pervasive, neither the constitutional theorist nor the judge has any place to stand. The denial of any moral reality beyond mere convention is both culpable and incoherent, and leads to different but equally destructive errors. If, as the late Judge Bork argued, there is no principled way to navigate competing moral claims, then the only option is for the proponents of judicial restraint to remain silent. I get this. His position has the virtue of being entirely consistent. And I understand why that recommends itself. On the other side, moral nihilists, admitting nature has no moral content, fill the void with surrogates of their own design. These reconstructions are admittedly devoid of any normative authority and range from generally accepted standards, the zip code theory of jurisprudence, and idiosyncratic conceptions of democracy, to radically personal convictions. It is worth considering where these theories, translated into styles of constitutional interpretation, lead. The best example that I can give you is Aaron Barak, the former Chief Justice of the Israeli Supreme Court, It's safe to talk about him. he's very candid about what he believes and how he does this. He also doesn't have a constitution, so it's a little bit better. Anyway, he argues that judges must defend democracy by defining ultimate values. He suggests, quote, a process of common conviction must take place among enlightened members of society regarding the truth and justice of norms and standards that people cherish before we can say that a general will has been reached and that these should become binding. Presumably, when the elite's consensus changes, so does the law. Coupled with judging based on abstract generalities stated in a single word like dignity, this approach allows judges to impose subjective predispositions under the guise of an objective standard. A very similar defense of judicial subjectivity can be found in Justice Breyer's book, Active Liberty. It seems to me that judicial quietism and judicial adventurism are both problematic. The result is either democratic despotism or judicial supremacy. Neither bodes well for the sustainability of American constitutionalism. On this record, it is hard not to sympathize with the proponents of judicial restraint, and I consider myself to be one of them. It is a principled position, and there are good reasons to fear arbitrary discretion in the courts and to promote what Judge Bork called the morality of the jurist, a discipline that requires judges to abstain from giving their own desires free play. Self-restraint is part of judicial prudence, but the founders clearly believed human nature provided a standard by which to judge political institutions. The arguments for ratification marshaled in the Federalist Papers were framed in terms of presumptively real moral considerations and recognition of the real failings inherent in human enterprise. James McClellan, Story's biographer, focuses on the perceived inconsistencies in Story's natural law jurisprudence. He gets very hung up on that. He wonders whether his approach owes more to Burke or Adams, whether it is Hobbesian or Lockean, or more indebted to the classical Christian tradition. I think finding some precise correlation is beside the point. Story was a child of the American Revolution. Ideas about liberty, duty, and sacred honor were part of the air he breathed. He had in common with the founding generation a deep understanding of the way the axioms and first principles of moral reasoning were integral to the telos that defined American constitutionalism. He, like the drafters of our constitutional documents, assumed that any good regime must respect the nature of the creature to be governed. Man was a creature of the Logos whose rational nature, created by the God of the Logos, was guided by the moral law engraved in every heart. The obligatory force of the law of nature, said Justice Story, is derived from its presumed coincidence with the will of the Creator. Yet he begins his discourse by observing that the law of nature is that system of principles which human reason has discovered. These reflections illustrate a very fundamental distinction between the vision of natural law embraced by the founders and revered by American conservatives and the progressive idea of inevitable transformative progress. The progressive idea highlights the difference between progress in science and technology, which can be cumulative, and progress in morals and politics, which must start again with every generation. There is a deep paradox in the progressive insistence that the nature of history is settled and the nature of man open to any definition that captures the imagination of the moment. To install this view of humanity is to take away precisely what the Constitution sought to preserve. John Adams said he always viewed the settlement of America with reverence and wonder as the opening of a grand scene and design in Providence for the illumination of the ignorant and the emancipation of the slavish part of mankind all over the earth. He was not alone in this view. Those who pledged their lives, their fortunes, and their sacred honor in those revolutionary times repeatedly gave credit to a beneficent providence, to divine intervention, to being in the hands of a good providence. In fact, even now, hardly anyone who reads about the harrowing days of the Revolutionary War escapes the intuition that America's success was something more than serendipity. In retrospect, there must be more than a frisson of awareness that something extraordinary was afoot. Phyllis Tickle hypothesizes that the hinge of history shifts dramatically roughly every 500 years. 500 years backwards takes us to the Great Reformation. Leszek Kolakowski's long view of history echoes in a shorter time frame some of the same elements of mythic struggle. He invokes St. Augustine's poetic trope in the City of God, recalling how God enriches history by the same kind of antithesis that gives beauty to poetry. There is beauty in the composition of the world's history arising from the antitheses of contraries, a kind of eloquence in events instead of words. Thus he concludes, the devil often tries with great success to convert good into evil, but the battle is never ceded to him. God, Kolakowski says, may reforge evil, havoc, and destruction into instruments of his own design. The point of his essay is that the Reformation, which was intended to purify Christianity, morphed into the Enlightenment, which began by seeking to free politics from the fetters of religion and matured by insisting the progress of humanity consisted in forgetting religious tradition altogether. And this flaw, this twisting of light into darkness, had the potential to turn politics into a sheer struggle for power. Stanley Rosen says the Enlightenment led to the repudiation of reason. By reducing all that is not objectively verifiable to the realm of rhetoric, rationalism reduces truth to a matter of perspective and makes all perspectives equal. And since our choices can only be justified rhetorically, that is, by reference to compassion or philanthropy or utility, even equality is debased, reduced to the equal right of all desires to be satisfied. In this new world, the assertion of a perspective becomes its justification. The claim is that a particular perspective serves the general welfare. What is really served is the will to power. The rationalist branch of the Enlightenment provided the impetus for the French Revolution. John Adams contrasted what the French philosophers called reason with reason rightly understood. The American Revolution rejected the idea of reason that made war on human nature. The mistake of the French revolutionaries, in Adams' view, was not contempt for tradition, it was contempt for man. Natural rights, rightly understood, was a framework for governance that respected man's immutable nature. In the words of the poet, two roads diverged, and we took the one less traveled by, and now we know, ages and ages hence, that has made all the difference. Or at least for about 150 years, it seemed like it would. But liberty is hard. Free government is not inevitable. It is only a possibility that can be fully realized when the polity is generally governed by the recognized imperatives of the universal moral law. It requires self-control and self-restraint, people capable of understanding that, in Acton's words, freedom is not the power of doing what we like, but the right of being able to do what we ought. Natural law cannot always produce easy answers, and sometimes it cannot produce any. It is a response to a hard question. In the words of the psalmist, what is man that you made him a little lower than the angels? This is both glory and curse, and in trying to design a government of the people, for the people, and by the people, we must relish the tension that is an inherent part of humanity. We are not brutes, we are not gods. Before architects had structural steel and rebar to allow buildings to extend easily upward, early builders invented a partial solution, flying buttresses. It was this innovation that made the soaring naves of Gothic cathedrals possible. Thus the buildings stood and the spaces reached heavenward, not in spite of the tensions generated by opposing forces, but because of them. Human beings are similarly designed. So the longings of our heart and the destiny of our souls are forever straining against each other. What left and Unger see as the devastating antinomies, of modern human thought, those basic positions about reality that are simultaneously necessary and contradictory, the framers would easily have recognized. Did not St. Paul voice the same antinomy in Romans 7? I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. And so I find this law at work. When I want to do good, evil is right there with me. For thousands of years, the idea of natural law played a dominant role in both philosophy and history. Cicero, Justice Story's favorite among the ancient writers, tells us true law is reason, right and natural, its validity is universal, it is immutable and eternal. Calvin Coolidge approved similar sentiments in a wonderful speech given in 1926 to celebrate the 150th anniversary of the Declaration of Independence. He lamented that most of those who clamor for reform are sincere but ill-informed. Were they more knowledgeable, he believed they would realize America's foundation was spiritual, not material, and the founders were people influenced by a great spiritual development who acquired a great moral power. To Coolidge, only the exercise of God's providence seemed adequate to explain the Declaration of Independence, and he did not believe it should be discarded for something more modern. He concludes, if all men are created equal, that is final. If they are endowed with inalienable rights, that is final. If governments derive their just power from the consent of the governed, that is final. No advance, no progress can be made beyond these propositions. If anyone wishes to deny their truth and their soundness, the only direction in which he can proceed historically is not forward, but backward, toward the time when there was not equality, not rights of the individual, no rule of the people. Those who wish to proceed in that direction cannot lay claim to progress. They are reactionary. Coolidge is exactly right, but now his insight seems counterintuitive. But even after the Great Depression, the spell had not been entirely broken. Speaking at a conference of Ninth Circuit judges, I was really surprised that these were Ninth Circuit judges, but it was in 1946. Harold McKinnon anticipated Arthur Leff by three decades, warning of the essentially anti-democratic and totalitarian political and legal philosophies gaining ground in American universities. Such teachings, McKinnon believed, denied the essential elements of a regime devoted to the preservation of natural rights. He argued that denying the existence of a moral law inherent in human nature, which limits government coercion, would be but a prelude to tyranny. If there is no higher law, there are no natural rights, and if there are no natural rights, the Bill of Rights is a delusion, and everything which man possesses, his life, his liberty, and his property, are held by sufferance of government, and if there are no external truths, if everything changes, everything, then we may not complain when the standard of citizenship changes from freedom to servility, and when democracy relapses into tyranny. Remarkably, our regime never made the unnecessary choice between truth and reason, and for a time rejected the strict separation between what is just and what is legal. And it is this thread, a conviction that there is such a thing as human nature, it is fixed and cannot be changed, and that this same nature provides a standard by which to judge political institutions that unites John Adams, Joseph Story, and Calvin Coolidge. To turn away from the principles of 1776 and 1778 is to turn back toward arbitrary government. That is why the idea of repointing the Constitution is a useful analog, as it suggests not only repairing, but repenting and reorienting. In the early days of the Republic, patriots hoped fervently for the perpetuity of the Constitution. They were exquisitely sensitive to the fragility of free institutions. Story expressed his well-founded fears in a powerful metaphor. In our government, he said, the centrifugal force is far greater than the centripetal. Thus, the danger was not that we would fall into the sun, but that we would fly off in eccentric orbits and never return to our perihelion. What he feared came to pass. The nation's Faustian bargain could not be sustained. The Civil War and the Civil War amendments shifted the balance from the state to the national government. America was granted what Lincoln called a new birth of freedom. The Declaration became an explicit part of the Constitution. But our time is different. Our task is different. In our age, the sun has collapsed, becoming a dark star, a cosmic phenomenon sometimes called a black hole, with a gravitational pull so strong it can bend light and hold time hostage. Our peril is not that we will fly too far from the sun, rather it is that we are already too close. so close that liberty may be entirely extinguished by the centripetal force that overwhelms even the idea of limits. Perhaps in a liberal democracy, government cannot be limited. The constitutional republic is bound only by a law of laws, and being a monopolist on all law enforcement can always untie itself. Instead, in contemporary parlance, liberalism no longer has anything to do with limited government. The regulatory state has expanded its reach to encompass education, social welfare, and even the transmission of culture. Judge and legal scholar Michael McConnell borrows, without embracing, a distinction articulated by John Rawls between political liberalism and comprehensive liberalism. A political conception of justice applies to the framework of basic institutions, whereas a comprehensive doctrine is one that addresses all aspects of life, including conceptions of what is of value, ideals of personal character, and ideals of friendship and mediating institutions. The constitutional principles of early American history limited the way government could conduct the public business, but did not purport to tell citizens how they should live their lives. The First Amendment followed exactly this approach. The American Constitution, McConnell writes, was an attempt to create a government strong enough to keep the peace and promote economic prosperity without the power to affect or coerce the ordinary lives or beliefs of a heterogeneous people. Contrast that thought with today's new vision, that the state should force citizens to be neutral, tolerant, egalitarian, and open-minded. And by the way, I have to pause here to say that some wisdom I learned at my grandmother's knee, one was, it's a fine thing to have an open mind, but your mind should not be so open that everything in it falls out. Or, as C.S. Lewis says much more succinctly, if your mind is open on these ultimate questions, please let your mouth be shut. Or consider the even more ominous view that government should force citizens to accept a singular, secular vision of the good. This is where I think deference to the enlightened elite will take us, to a sterile, secular, uniformly dull, and featureless vision of the future where we will all be Democrats, but Democrats who lack any sort of faith worth fighting for. While the earlier natural rights tradition filled gaps in a way that strengthened the Charter of Freedom, the newer understanding constrains, constricts, and reduces. This new mortar does not strengthen, it shatters the whole edifice. Limited government should mean limited judges too. But so long as we have unlimited government, we may need a less limited view of the legitimate role of judges. Judges may need to intervene for the sake of individual liberty, and they must sometimes do so with reference to ultimate values. Western civilization's great achievement has been to discover and synthesize a network of principles that jointly undergird individual liberty. That achievement owes fealty to both rationality and sacredness, both Athens and Jerusalem. Somehow, those two sources of value jointly should and must inform the act of judging. The solutions offered by Holmes and Rawls and theorists like Dworkin, Unger, and Left end either in might making right or in a coerced virtue based on an unnatural law that seems contrary to Athens and Jerusalem both, to the entire network of principles undergirding individual liberty. While it would take more chutzpah than I possess to suggest an exhaustive answer to the question of how to define the ultimate values that inform responsible judging in a constitutional democracy, there is some usefulness in saying no to obvious errors. The error of taking the perceived opinion among a certain social group and mistaking it for democratic consensus. The error of any construction of the Constitution that authorizes unlimited government, positive rights, when the clear import of the Constitution, its text, context, and history, is the creation of a government of limited powers aimed at protecting negative rights. The error of indifference to the writtenness of the Constitution. Writtenness has two sides. Conservative judges have vigorously resisted the importation of extra textual ideas. They have been much less adept at effectuating limits that are in the text. This is the point of recent books challenging judicial abdication, and their criticism of excessive deference has some validity. it is no more principle to permit actual limits to be written out of the Constitution than it is to insert obligations that were never there. This is a modest proposal. No theory of everything is in the offing. In fact, I think Farber is right that brilliance, defined as new ideas that turn conventional thinking on its head, should count heavily against any legal theory. Neither the reason that has destroyed divine authority or the untrammeled will that destroyed self-government can be endured. We must live with our tensions, for the true way is in the middle. Politics is downstream of culture, and the cultural problem will always turn out to be a religious problem. Rather than fleeing from the sacred, perhaps we must embrace it. In the Orthodox Jewish tradition, the world is filled with God's glory. Protestants secured a law-free space in which to encounter God. In the city of man, governed by the grand says who, the world is filled with law. In other words, the source of our differences may well be religious, for a person's or a nation's relationship to liberty is a spiritual matter. Coolidge was right about that. Still, we cannot have it both ways. For the promise of the permissive cornucopia offered by the unlimited state, we give up freedom. Earlier, I acknowledged that if the state is limitless, maybe judges must be too, but that's second best. The unlimited state is never a mere instrumentality. It cannot remain neutral to the good. The question is not whether we will change with the times. We will. The question is whether we can repoint our Constitution so that we may preserve the fortress stones, renewing the legal, political, and constitutional principles that made us an exceptional nation, a wonder in the world, the land of the free. It turns out that if we would be free, the unjudged judge is a logical necessity. Some widespread consensus must exist. Even Hayek concedes the preservation of a constitution of liberty requires commitment to a meta-narrative privileging ordered liberty. Otherwise, liberty loses to expediency every time. The grand says who is not enough. If you want liberty, something more awesome, powerful, glorious, worthy of reverence and unquestioning obedience is required. Something like the spirit that moved upon the deep and spoke the world into being, the one who lit the sun and laid earth's cornerstone when the morning stars sang together, the God of the Logos, the great I am.
I think you can see from that response how much we appreciate your fine words today. And the judge has agreed to take a few questions. And who would like to ask the first question? Yes. Roger?
Thank you very much, Judge. I really enjoyed that. I'm Roger Clegg with the Center for Equal Opportunity. Let me ask you this. Would an atheist judge go about deciding the meaning of the Constitution differently from a Christian judge? And why or why not?
Wow. I thought these were going to be easy questions. That is really interesting. I don't know. It's because some of my best friends are libertarians. And they are mostly people who do not believe in a supernatural being. But nevertheless, I think they would recognize that if you're going to have limited government, something must be the source of authority. The problem with this lack of normative foundation is all you get is you know, whatever anybody wants to do. So I would hope that if, in fact, you're atheist or Christian, it wouldn't really make any difference as long as you are committed to the limited nature of the regime.
Okay, the next question. Yes.
I'm Evan Burnick. I'm with the Institute for Justice. You've talked a lot about the Declaration of Independence this evening and its role in setting forth fixed truths about human nature and about the role of government that are true everywhere and always. And you also made reference to the 14th Amendment as a means of bringing the Declaration into the Constitution explicitly. More than one justice over the last few years, including famously Justice Scalia, has said that the Declaration of Independence is not part of our law. And Justice Kagan, in her nomination hearing, was actually, her confirmation hearing rather, was asked a question about the Declaration of Independence, and she said basically, to the extent that there are rights out there, I wouldn't want you to think that I should enforce those rights. So how would you respond to that, and do you have any broader thoughts about the Declaration and its reference to the Constitution?
Well, you know, it's clear that the Declaration was not part of the original Constitution. There's a kind of interesting debate about that. One of the things that McClellan says is, well, you know, they didn't put that in the Constitution because by the time they got around to drafting the Constitution, they were so over all that natural rights stuff, right? I mean, that was done, that was a kind of exuberant thing that they did, but then when they got around to the Constitution, they were very sober, and they did not bring that up again. My own feeling is that the reason that they did not say anything when they drafted the Constitution about the Declaration of Independence was they understood what those words meant. And just as it happened in Massachusetts, it would have meant the end of slavery, right? I mean, that language was very powerful. So I think that's why it wasn't, because they were very careful in the Constitution. They were trying to hold this together. They were trying not to make, to keep this compromise working. And so they were very circumspect in all of their language about slavery. And they didn't say anything that would immediately precipitate that. But I still think that that was a background consideration to what they were doing. I don't think it was just, sort of something that happened because they were trying to justify declaring their independence. So I think that that was always in the background of what was happening. And I think the Civil War Congress, the Republicans, clearly thought that that's what they were doing. They said so. So I don't know. I mean, I can't answer your question about how other judges look at this and, decide that this is not there and that we should not have any concern about it. I mean, we have a court that has just, refused to acknowledge that privileges and immunities is in the Constitution. So we have, clearly there are currents in the jurisprudence of the Supreme Court that I cannot explain. And won't try to. So.
Manny?
Thank you. Manny Klausner from the Reason Foundation and the Individual Rights Foundation. This is a great moment for Heritage Foundation and a great moment for the audience and the broadcast audience. My question, back to your theme of repointing the Constitution, would you look for the type of mortar that wouldn't be too strong, but maybe would be the best for preserving the bricks of the Constitution? A little bit of Lochnerism in that mortar?
Whoa.
Speak into the mic for the television.
He keeps telling me I have to speak into the mic because of the, I forget, I'm a pacer. Boy. Well, I'm going to take the coward's way out here. I am a sitting judge, so I'm going to decide that discretion is the better part of valor, and I am not going to say anything more about that.
John?
So I want to pose a question. Did the declaration come in only via the 14th Amendment, privileges and immunities, or was it in the main document itself? Because there's also privileges and immunities, there's a guarantee of Republican form of government. There are some principles there that seem to follow the declaration. We, granted, have compromises with those principles, and we have to live side by side. But isn't the root there first? And if it is, how should a judge go about giving voice to those original claims?
You know, I think that you make a good point, and I believe that there was much in what they did, which because my point in really focusing on the Declaration of Independence was what was it that they saw as necessary to limit government, because they had, you know, this was the new thing that they thought they were seeing, you know, in terms of governance. One, that consent had to come from the people, and two, that there were limits on what government could do to coerce a certain kind of creature, right? So I think that was very much a part of what they were doing, and that there are several things in the Constitution which probably reflect that. But I have to acknowledge that they were very careful. I would say, you know, even the preamble has a little flavor of that, but I think they were very careful not to say that out loud.
So. Clark?
I'll try to give you the easy question.
Thank you. I've been waiting for the easy question. By the way, Heritage promised me only softball questions. I need to have a little truth in advertising discussion with them.
Well, I don't know if it's a softball question, but I think you'll get a base hit at least. You know, you've served with a lot of different judges in your career, and I'm curious, can you identify one or two qualities that are the qualities that you think you find most admirable and desirable in judges from both sides of the aisle? But what are those one or two qualities that you think really are the hallmarks of a good judge and the kind of judge we should want on our courts?
Wow. Well, you know, it's funny. I have been on a lot of courts, and I've served with a lot of different judges, and all of them are quite different. But I think for me, the thing that I like when I have a colleague who really, is engaged, that really wants to dig into it, who's there because they love the work and it interests them. And who are willing to, take the extra time to thoroughly investigate something, and especially someone who, you know, when you have a disagreement, and this is the thing about appellate courts, you know, if you're a trial judge, you are the king. You know, your word is law. You can just, whatever you say, you are like Yul Brynner as Ramses II, you know, in the Ten Commandments. You work around, you say, so let it be written, so let it be done. It's, you know, it's over. But when you're on an appellate court, it's a symphony. It's a concerto. It's never a solo. And so you've always got to have the ability to work with the other judges. And so one of the things that to me, is one of the best characteristics of a judge is somebody who, when you have a disagreement, actually goes back and thinks it through. Doesn't just, grudgingly put in a couple of words and say, okay, I've addressed your concern. But it goes back and actually says, how does that idea change the way I was approaching this opinion? You know.
Okay. Nick.
I think we've done. I hope so.
Well, Judge, one of the things that we present in recognition both of your distinguished career as a judge and in the other jobs that you've done, but also of your talk this evening and your excellent thoughts and ideas and the thinking and research that went into your fine work for tonight's talk. This is our Statue of Liberty, Defender of Liberty Award,
wow.
And we're happy to present this to you.
This is gorgeous.
And
thank
also,
you so much.
With it, we have a...
Oh!
We have the
commentaries
on the Constitution of the United States in two volumes by Joseph Story.
Oh, this is gorgeous.
And
this
also what we call the Familiar Exposition of the Constitution of the United States by Joseph Story. And with all modesty, I must say it has a foreword by me.
Oh, wow. Thank you so much.
So now if you'll join us all, and we have in the foyer, we will have a reception where you can personally meet the judge. But before we leave, I just want to thank you again personally for being with us, for all you have done for the law, and particularly for being with us tonight. Thank you very much.
Thank you.